most prominent resident that Bridgewater has had, Mr. Bob O'Shea. So, this truly is a very special afternoon, it's an honor for me to be able to stand up here before you. And quite frankly, I'm not sure I'd be standing up here before you if not for Mr. Vaucher. It's a mutual admiration society, I believe, between Bob and I. And his advice from the very first time I got into the council, now 13 years ago, Bob was still in meetings, giving advice, opinions, telling us when we were right, telling us when we were wrong, letting us know if we were wrong, making sure other people knew if we were wrong, and making sure that we got it right by the end. And Bob has continued to serve the community for decades and decades. And I can only hope that when my time in public service is done, I will have accomplished even a fraction of what Bob has accomplished for Bridgewater and for our country over his entire lifetime. So, Bob, I'm not sure that we're going to be able to say enough words to really recognize your contributions, but thank you for everything that you've done, for allowing us to be here today to celebrate our country, celebrate you, and celebrate public service overall. I'd like to take a moment now to recognize our council members who are in the audience. We have Council Vice President Felipe Pedroso, who's here. We have Councilman Alan Cardilla. Councilman Sam Ring, Councilman Michael Kirsch is in the back. Council President Howard Regalis unfortunately had a last minute family conflict that came up, so he sends his regards. He would otherwise be here. At this time, I'd like to invite Fielder Brian Gallagher to come up and say Pledge of Allegiance.
Somerset County, who created and helped to create global history. Not many communities can boast that they have a man of this caliber living in their town. It didn't end there. When he came back, settled in Bridgewater, he helped to craft the new history of Bridgewater, what it is today, how it's shaped, how it evolved. So, you know, you go out and you talk to people and they all talk about what you should be doing, what you shouldn't be doing. Here's a man who spent his life showing people how it's done. He's a true gentleman. He's a wonderful, wonderful man. I've known him for many years. He's an absolute patriot. And I think this is an extremely fitting honor for a wonderful gentleman. So thank you, sir, and thank you to Bridgewater for crafting this honor. Thank you, Mayor. Great job. Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to invite up Reverend Ronald Pollock from the St. John's Episcopal Church to say an invocation. Reverend,
I too find myself to be profoundly grateful for the opportunity to get to know T. Robert Vaucher, Lieutenant Colonel. When I first arrived at St. John's 23 years ago, I met a wonderful man, a human being who is larger than life and provided many life lessons. I happen to be a student of Bob Vaucher, and I know I join you being able to just listen and learn and just give God thanks for the incredible benefits and gifts that we've received through Bob O'Shea. And today, here we are, the Vaucher Revolutionary Preserve. Preserve at Steele's Gap.
Wow.
In your name. And further down in this magnificent invitation, and to recognize all those Americans who served and sacrificed in World War II on the 75th anniversary of their victory. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, when time stands still, when all that's gone ahead and all that lies behind is caught up in the mystery of this moment, give us grateful hearts. May we always be mindful of those heroes who have walked the path before us, and may we pause to thank them and to give you thanks, O God. In all of these things we pray.
Thank you, Reverend. I'd like to also acknowledge we have Senator Tom Kaine is here. So thank you, Senator, for coming. He had a citation which he presented to Bob earlier. When we talk about service, I'm not sure that there's any generation or group of individuals that exemplify service more than the greatest generation. Those such as Bob, who were called to service for our country at a time when we faced unprecedented evil and really world at a world level that we've never seen and hopefully we'll never see again. And we talk a lot, of course, about World War II veterans and for their dedication and sacrifice and bravery, but I think what also exemplifies that commitment to service is not just what veterans do when they serve during their time in the service, but how many veterans then continue to serve their communities. And I think Bob, of course, is probably the greatest example of that. But people who serve in our armed forces, they understand community and service better than so many of us who haven't served. And I hope that we will continue at Bridgewater to find ways of engaging our veterans to get involved in our community. Earlier this year, the council passed a resolution creating the Bridgewater Veterans Advisory Committee. And that committee is now, we did appointments a couple weeks ago. And the purpose of the committee is not just to honor veterans, it's part of it. But as I had some veterans tell me, that what's really important is trying to tap into their dedication, their sense of community, their willingness to work to benefit the greater good, and to find ways of truly engaging the veterans who live here in Bridgewater in a larger Somerset community to put their talents to work and to continue to remind us of the sacrifices and all the freedoms that we enjoy are because of the dedication and service of those members who have served like Bob. So I'd like to invite up some of our members from the newly formed Bridgewater Veterans Advisory Committee to say a few words about the armed services and their experiences and what it means to them. So I'd like to invite up Michael Medades, one of our members, to come up and say a few words.
Okay, thank you, Mayor Mensch. Honored Lieutenant Colonel Vaucher, Councilman. My comments are about America and the home front during World War II. I was not a veteran, but I honor and respect our veterans. The 16 million Americans who served during the Second World War, inspired and impelled by the belief that they were engaged in an epic struggle to defeat evil enemies. The righteousness of their mission was shared and reinforced by the total support of a unified nation. The American people made tremendous sacrifices to transform our nation into an industrial war machine that the totalitarian Axis powers could not match. During World War II, production of civilian vehicles and many consumer goods were stopped. The media was predominantly focused on the war, and food supplies were rationed. Facing these sacrifices, women and teenagers, out of patriotism and necessity, took jobs previously performed by men at war. To produce the most advanced ships, tanks, planes, and munitions, 24 million Americans worked in defense-related industries out of a total population of 140 million. More than 6 million women became employed in America's industrial war machine. They were represented as Rosie the Riveter. For example, a factory in Georgia producing the B-29 aircraft flown by Lieutenant Colonel Vaucher employed 30,000 people, with more than half of them being women. My father was a 10-year-old boy living in Staten Island 75 years ago. He remembers that the war was the predominant focus of everyday life. There were air raid drills, searchlights at night to locate enemy aircraft, and ubiquitous wartime media campaigns, such as Loose Lips Sink Ships and the growing of Victory Gardens, which Americans diligently followed. His house had three stars on the windows. They represented the three service members in his family, and this was a sign of honor. Americans made sacrifices to thwart German submarines, which were just off of our shores. To protect ships leaving ports at night from German torpedoes, the lights in the city went dark in Staten Island, and only very dim lights were used. People even painted the top parts of car headlights black to minimize the light. My father worked shining shoes at the entrance to the port of Staten Island. His parents didn't ask him to do this, but he wanted to make some money and support the war effort. He rode his bike down to the port. One time he got a tip of $20. That's worth about $300 from a sailor. He was so surprised he asked the longshoreman about this tip, and the longshoreman said, where he's going, he's not going to need that money. Another time, just outside the entrance to the port, he saw German POWs and got so scared that he never went back to that area. The story of how free and unified Americans conquered the despotic Axis powers to preserve freedom on Earth is vital for all Americans to understand and appreciate today. Thank you. We're gonna now have Michelle Smith, who is a veteran of the United States Marine Corps, come and speak.
Hi, good afternoon, Lieutenant Colonel. It's an honor to be standing here in front of you on the day that you get recognized for your lifelong dedication, not only to the town, but to our country, and being part of the greatest generation ever. I can't stand being still. Anybody who knows me knows that. And I really like what Mike said about the community and how that had a sense in what we do in times of trouble. I want to talk about, though, some of the big things that happened in World War II, right? Everybody knows December 7th, a day that'll live in infamy. It's a day that sailors and Marines and Army were taken off guard. It was a day that shook America to its core, a day where we had to decide as a country that we've had enough. There were battles all along the South Pacific. There were battles all along Europe. These were battles that were fought by young kids. Because you think about it, when people go in the military, right, they're between the ages of 18 and 24. They're invincible. But it was a time of reality for the United States. It was a time where we had to face the fact that we were attacked on our own soil. And heroes were born. Heroes like Bob. I shouldn't call you that. I should really call you Lieutenant Colonel, but you're just Bob, everybody's neighbor, the guy who does everything for everybody. But there were also people, John Bassalone, right? Our neighbor. You know, he fought in the Battle of Guadalcanal and got awarded for his bravery there. His first day at Iwo Jima, he was killed after he saved other people's lives and held off. But not everybody who's a hero gets their name in history. Where I work, I'm lucky enough to see heroes. And when I started there 100 years ago, there was a lot of World War II vets. There were veterans who were prisoner of war and who had the best defense. The one story I actually really love is this guy told me, he's like, yeah, I was in a POW camp. I was like, how did you survive? He's like, passive-aggressive behavior works. I was like, okay, what does that mean? Because I know what it means clinically. He would pick the lice out of his body every morning and go up to the German captain, shake him on the back, say, good morning, sir, walk away. He's a hero. The Tuskegee Airman, who thought that he, who was also a POW, who thought he did what he had to do and that was it. He broke racial barriers. He broke every kind of barrier he could. But what he was proud of is surviving, getting out, and being a principal in a high school and surviving that. These are also heroes. These are the people that have accepted life and have accepted their circumstances and did the best they could with what they had. These are the people that we're privileged enough to call veterans. These are the people that we want to serve. These are the people that deserve to be served. So, with that being said, I just wanted to add a couple more things about. So people will come up to me because I'm a Marine Corps veteran, yes, complete with tattoos, you know? And they will say, you know, what can we do? There's so many different things that we could do. So many things that really don't cost time or money. Stuff like saying thank you. Thank you for your service. There are things that we could do by just acknowledging that there are so many veterans out there who need help and who don't know how to get help. I mean, after all my time in the Marine Corps, I never realized that I rated VA benefits, that I could go to health care. Now I work there. There are things that we could do, provide information, say thank you, even when we're in a gathering. The Pledge of Allegiance. Ask a veteran, would you mind leading this today? Let's look at the veteran and their skills. Let's look at their contributions that they've made. Let's look at their heart, at what they have to bring to us. And let's involve them. They're your neighbors, coworkers, bosses, employees. Let's involve them, and that's why I'm so grateful to the mayor and the council that we're having a veteran committee, a veteran advisory committee. I work at the Veteran Advisory Council, so I'm always confused. This is an opportunity, and this is an opportunity, hopefully, that people will be finding out more and more what the town's going to be doing and how you could be part of it. Because our veterans deserve it, but even more so, our town deserves it. Now, it brings a sense of patriotism. It brings a sense of safety. It brings a sense of belonging when we include veterans. And veterans come in all shapes, sizes, forms, sexes, colors, everything. Kind of like Bridgewater. So I look forward to working on the council. Lieutenant Colonel, I can't even say thank you enough. Because even after you got out, you showed everybody what it means to be a veteran, what it means to have value and to bring it to everybody's life, and what it means to acknowledge, or not even acknowledge, to take away the stigma that a lot of people carry around about veterans. Because what do you read in newspapers? Oh my God, a veteran did this. Well, Bridgewater is now hopefully going to be like, oh my God, our veterans are doing this and we're part of it. So thank you all for the opportunity. Thank you, Mayor. and I'm going to sit down.
I should have mentioned that when we were looking to put together the Veterans Committee, we were talking about it last year, Michelle gave, I have a sort of an email, it's printed out in my office, about 2 pages of suggestions and ideas on things the committee can do. And if you couldn't talk from her remarks, you know, she works at the VA hospital, continuing to serve veterans, and also speaks on behalf of women's veterans issues in various capacities. And Michael, who I've spoken before, Tim, your phone's ringing. I'm going to give the councilman a hard time. Michael, for those of you who have seen or participated in the Flag Day celebration, was something that started how many years ago now?
7 years ago.
7 years ago. I think the first one was in at Duke Island Park, and it started with a small committee, and as for those who participated in Somerville, it's grown to be quite an event, complete with folks being becoming United States citizens, with all the military vehicles, and really a whole day celebrating the flag, what it means, and patriotism. So these are two individuals who put their money where their mouth is when it comes to service to their community and trying to really foster a sense of true appreciation for what we have here in America. At this time, it is my honor to introduce Council Vice President Felipe Pedroso, who has some remarks, and we'll talk to us today. So please come up, Council.
Good afternoon, thank you all for being here. Could I just have a show of hands, how many World War II vets do we have in the house? How many veterans are there? People have served. Thank you. So I took the time really to thank you all for your service to our country. Something that I could have an opportunity to do myself, but I value strongly the time that you've given, and so thank you very much. Also, I've been on the council for over eight years now, and I've never asked to speak at an event. And this is actually the first event that I made a request to say a few words. And so I want to thank Mayor Mensch for allowing me the opportunity and honor to be here today and to speak about the Foothill Civic Association and Lieutenant Colonel Bob Foucher. I know Mayor Mensch is a patriot. I've known him for many, many years. I served on the council with him for 8 years. And I know that he values strongly the service that vets do to our country. This committee that is established under his leadership and was really something that's been on his mind for a long time. Very important to him. So thank you, Mayor, for doing this with him today and creating this committee. So thank you. I have a few words about the Foothill Civic Association, and I usually don't write speeches, but because of the importance here today and really to get this right for Bob, I took the time to write this down. The Foothill Civic Association was an organization founded in 1925. By Bridgewater residents who care deeply about Bridgewater and protecting the residents' quality of life. Today, we celebrate and acknowledge the designation of the former Wemple property as the Vaucher Revolutionary Preserve by Steele Gap. Mr. John Wemple's father was one of the original founders of the Foothill Civic Association. The history of this parcel of land is extraordinary, from its role in the Revolutionary War to the genesis of the Foothill Civic Association, to Mr. Bob Foucher himself. This land has passed on a legacy of courage, civic duty, and civil responsibility. The Foothill Civic Association, from its early roots in the now now Vaucher Revolutionary Preserve, to the present day, has had a paramount importance in the way that Bridgewater was developed, preserved, and organized. But we can't talk about the Foothill Civic Association without talking about Bob Vaucher. Bob moved to Bridgewater in 1950. Recently married at the time, his wife, a Somerville resident, dragged Bob into town. They settled on Foothill Road in Bridgewater. We are all very fortunate for the good judgment of Mrs. Vaucher for both marrying Bob and dragging Bob into Bridgewater. Bob still lives in the same house, purchased back then for $21,000. Quite a pretty good investment, Bob. Within a very short time, Bob found himself as a volunteer with the Greenville Fire Department. Probably not coincidental, Bob's residence, almost across the street from Mr. Wemple, resulted in Bob's improvement into the Foothill Civic Association. As Bob said to me, quote, "They were looking for a young guy, someone like me to kick around and make noise." The noise he did. From his initial beginnings with the Foothill Civic Association to the present day, Bob has made lots and lots of great noise. Bob's initial task for the Foothill Civic Association was leading the fight against the drive-in movie theater. At the time, Bridgewater was very different, mostly a farming town. So when the drive-in movie theater was proposed, it's no wonder that residents were not happy. While visiting his sister in Texas, Bob came to learn that the same movie theater company was having issues there. So, back in Bridgewater, Bob drilled the movie theater applicant at the hearing and alerted the town committee to issues that were being hidden. This resulted in a swift denial and Bob's first big win. As Bob told me, quote, "After this, the Foothill Civic Association jumped on me and got me mixed up in all sorts of things." And mixed up in things he got. It wasn't long before Bob took on a leadership role in the Foothill Civic Association. He used his organizational skills gained in the military to manage the Civic Association by dividing town into sections, establishing local leaders, and grew the influence of the association into a powerful force for protecting the public good, Bridgewater's character, and the town's quality of life. Bridgewater's population kept increasing. Over the years, the town's needs were changing. During Bob's earlier years, Bridgewater was composed of dairy farms, donkey farms, hay fields, and the Wemple property itself was a pasture for horses. But Bridgewater was needing a more modern and sophisticated government. So Bob went to Rutgers University's political science department to discuss a town that he described as, quote, "a sleepy little town that was growing." Bridgewater's government needed a better structure. Working with Rutgers, Bob came back with a proposal for a new form of government. The medium strong mayor council form of government that we have today. This was controversial at the time, with most of the then town committee members opposing it. Bob led the Foothill Civic Association in a movement to get a referendum passed. They succeeded with more than enough votes, and Bridgewater's government structure was changed to the system we now have today. Next on Bob's radar was the police. At the time, Bridgewater was serviced by the state police department. As the township was growing, Bob felt that the state police was unable to provide services that the township needed. So the Foothill Civic Association and Bob took on the task of establishing a Bridgewater Police Department. Through Bob's leadership, the Foothill Civic Association pushed for a public referendum to get public support and approval to create the police department. Not surprising, Bob was successful. Bridgewater was able to establish its police department. The same Bridgewater Police Department that exists today. So now the town had a modernized government structure and its first police department. What appeared next on Bob's radar wasn't a Japanese fire plane, but the lack of a high school in Bridgewater. Motivated in part by his daughter's needs and the great foresight and vision that Bob always had about the town's needs, Bob pushed for Bridgewater to establish a much-needed high school. So Bob got up, like any other typical big thing, and decided to go to the State Board of Education to get approval to build a high school in town. He had an obstacle. The state would not allow a high school to be built on a because Bridgewater was part of the school district. After considering several neighboring towns, Bob settled on Red. Again, the Foothill Civic Association and Bob got to work, doing what they did the best, fighting for the residents' best interests. In the Republican campaign, the Foothill Civic Association and Bob got public resolutions passed in both Raritan and Bridgewater. The Bridgewater-Raritan Regional School District was now formed. With that, Bob's daughters got a high school. And so did Bridgewater. In fact, Mayor Mitch, Councilman Ring, and I, just a few examples of pupils that benefited by going through the very school system that Bob is instrumental in establishing. Think about this for a moment. Bridgewater's home government, our police department, and our school system are all here today because of the hard work, vision, dedication, concerned leadership of Mr. Bob Shea. Through the years, the Foothill Civic Association and Bob will continue to be relentless in protecting their vision for a Bridgewater that grew with constraints, that maintained its character, and is now what it is because we have Bob looking out, developing a vision and fighting for what's best for this township. The Foothill Civic Association took on many fights against home development and always advocated for the Bridgewater residents. Although I don't have the time to go through every project, every fight, every campaign, there's just three I'd like to highlight very quickly. One, in the 287 extension project plan to go through Bridgewater, Bob was selected to go to the state to review the plans and provide input. Bob immediately had a concern that the state's plan would cut through residents' homes and persuaded the state to move the highway to follow along Route 22 and then right. The government representative took out his compass to make sure the turn could be made to handle military equipment and said okay. But Bob did notice that the proposed bends would cut through what is now hostile, a community of mostly Black Americans. Bob was concerned that the highway would displace what was at the time a lower income community. And so he asked the state to push the highway plan further west before moving north. So today, when you look at a map and you see 287 cut through Bridgewater from east to west, and then make a short turn to the right, well, you can blame Bob for that. But Bob's knowledge and concern, and the respect he was given, it resulted in residents not losing their homes and saved the entire community from being displaced. Number two, the Raritan Valley Community College exists today because of Bob's vision and persuasion. In the 1960s, Somerset County Freeholders appointed Bob to a six-person committee to explore the possibility of building a college in Somerset County. Bob traveled to Hartford, Long Island, to look at community colleges already operating. He returned feeling very positive about the opportunities that a community college would bring to the local community. However, others didn't share his view. The committee was split 3-3. Coincidentally, or likely through Bob's power of persuasion, the opposing chairwoman didn't show up to vote, and the committee passed the recommendation by a 3-2 vote. But that didn't end it. There was no location for the college. So Bob took the lead and recommended that the county use some of the Duke's estate in Hillsborough. Let's just say that didn't go too well in Mrs. Duke. So, to get rid of Bob, she purchased a tract of land in Bridgeport and donated it to the county. The Raritan Valley Community College was built there, and today it has educated thousands and thousands of local residents since its inception in 1965. In large part, it's the Bob. Number three. The very property that we celebrate here today, and that is being renamed the Vaucher Revolutionary Preserve, didn't come without a fight. It was a long fight, which leads me to how I met Bob. I was a member of the Bridgewater Zoning Board for about 10 years, prior to being elected to the council. During those 10 years, Bob was a consistent presence. He would often address the board on behalf of the Foothill Civic Association and many applications. The application to develop 18 homes on the then Wemple property was one of those. Bob spoke passionately against the zoning board approving the project, And although I agree with Bob and would have known, the development was approved. Bob didn't give up. I'm not sure he knows what those words mean. Bob kept the fight, and when the opportunity presented itself, he mobilized the Foothill Civic Association to preserve this parcel of land. Through the hard work of Bob, Dave Stipen, and Brendan Byrne, other donations were raised. And through a public, private, and government partnership, the then Wemple property was finally restored to its open space glory. As I hope you can tell, Bob Boucher's contributions to this township that I love and have called home since 1978 are many. I've highlighted some for you here today, but there are many more. As councilman, I thank you, Lieutenant Colonel Bob Boucher, on behalf of all Bridgewater residents, for doing what you did, for taking the time to advocate for the residents, for having a vision of the township, for the township to have a better government, safer neighborhoods, and greater education, for speaking out against overdevelopment, for alerting the community when its government representatives strayed from doing what was right, and for protecting the quality of life of Bridgewater for so many years. And as a resident, who moved here when I was 7, I thank you personally for everything you did to make Bridgewater a place that I'm proud to call home. I have no doubt that no one has contributed more towards what Bridgewater is today than Bob Boucher. Keep fighting for us for many years to come. I'd like to, at this point, introduce Mr. Andy Levin, who is a representative of Bridgewater Foothill Civic Association, who will in the future have big shoes to fill. Thank you.
But I'm really more thrilled at what our political leadership has done in honoring Bob in this way, and to some degree breaking from traditional convention in a way that I think is incredibly valuable and deeply appreciated. I only have a few things to say today, Bob, and they're really about you and about us. We all carry within us worries, fears, and anxieties, and maybe that's more visible now, I guess it is, has to be, but so it has always been. Just like it has always been that extraordinary people overcome these inhibitions, the inhibitions that are inside all of us, to accomplish hard things that are worth doing. And Bob, you have done, as Councilman Progresso very eloquently described, you have done many hard things worth doing. The one that I'm focusing on tonight, of course, is the Wemple property. And saving that property obviously took the work of a lot of people, including Dave Stempion, Brendan Byrne, Jeff Foose, Mayor Mensch, Council Members Morgales, Pedroso, Cordilla, the DNR Greenway Land Trust, and many others. Couldn't have happened without all of them, but fundamentally, at bottom, this whole thing rested on your commitment to John Wemple. You made a promise, and after years of effort, you delivered that promise. You made it good. I don't think I'm breaking any new ground when I say that we are living in upsetting and confusing times. When a person makes the effort, as you did, to keep a promise, it reminds all of us of what is possible if we too can push down our own inhibitions enough to do hard things that are worth doing. It's my honor and my privilege, Bob, to be your friend. And I speak for many others in saying that our community and our country are better because you are among us. Thank you, Bob, for all the very hard things that you've accomplished that have benefited so many others. And please accept the congratulations of the Foothill Civic Association on this very well-deserved honor.
Thank you, Mr. Levin. It's nice to see Andy on this side of the podium, on the same side as us, because Andy learned from Bob and is just as fierce an advocate on behalf of the public as Bob is. And Andy, as through all the time I've served in public service in some form or another, has been right there advocating on behalf of the quality of life in Bridgewater and working hard to make sure that the elected officials, the planning board members, the zoning board members do the right thing. And Bob, if it's any indication of what your legacy means to have people like Andy having followed your example, then Bridgewater is in good hands, because he certainly carries the torch very well for you and on behalf of the Foothill Association. And thank you, Council Vice President Pedroso, for all of your remarks. And I should comment that I don't know that there is an elected official right now that has been more adamant in fighting over development than Councilman Pedroso. And by the way, he was a no vote on developing the Wemple property when it was in front of the planning board. So you know, he continues to advocate stridently for making sure that we don't see the town that we love turned into something that we don't want it to be. So thank you, Councilman Pedroso, for all your remarks as well. And as everybody mentioned, we're here for the Wemple property, and as an example of what dedicated individuals and veterans can do, like Bob. And we wouldn't be here today also without the help of the DNR Greenway Association. And when we were looking, we talk about this a lot, this property, because it's not as much of a common story as you'd like to think, where you can have the public and the government and private organizations really come together to accomplish something great. And we've done that here. And DNR has been such a wonderful partner for us here in Bridgewater with this project. I only hope there's more ways we can find out to work with you. So keep us, you know, when we come to our properties, let's keep up. But I'd like to ask Linda Mead to come up and say a few words on behalf of DNR. When they walked into the room and we had this little meeting in our conference room, I didn't know then, first off, that Bob was close to 100 years old. He came in, we sat down, we had a wonderful meeting. Somewhere along the way, we got talking about all the things that Bob had accomplished in his life as a World War II veteran. And I thought, here is a formidable force. And I learned somewhere toward the end of that meeting, maybe it was Bob that told me two Bob stories that stick out in my mind. They're short. The first one was a couple years ago. I hurt my leg running, so I had to go to physical therapy and complaining about my leg, and I'm hurting, and I'm sitting there getting physical therapy, and I look over, and there's Bob doing the same physical therapy I'm doing. Happy as could be. I figured, I said, Bob, what are you doing here? Physical therapy. And, the way that he interacted, it was hysterical, of course, because we're doing the same thing, and we're a couple years apart in age. And all the people there, Bob walked in. There, Mr. Vaucher's here, and he had all that staff listening and working with him. And I still remember my look on my face. I think, when Bob, there I am doing the same. Bob doing the same exercises I'm doing, and doing them probably better than I was doing it at the time. And the other one, which I always keep in mind when we talk about what a force Bob can be for good. When we were talking last year, and he was telling stories and giving me some thoughts and advice. Start telling one story, he's talking, and he said, well, that mayor back in the 70s, he did this, and I supported him, but then he did this bad thing, and then he wasn't the mayor anymore. And then there's another mayor back in the late 70s or early 80s, and he did this thing, and I thought he was good at first, and then he wasn't, and then he wasn't the mayor anymore. So I'm very cognizant of that, Bob, and we'll continue to make sure that we're doing a good job here, because it was a very clear theme in your speeches and in our discussions. But as mayor, you get the honor of being the person who gets to stand up here and kind of emcee the event, and everyone thanks me for doing this. But at the end of the day, there's people who really deserve more credit than for putting this event together than I do. Wells Winninger, who's sitting in the back, is our deputy Township Administrator, and Scott Moraldo, who is our Director of Constituent Services, who's currently serving, he's in the reserves, and so he's currently doing his duty, which is why he's on here. They're the two who, on the Township staff side, really put this together. And Councilman Ring, we wouldn't be having this event and being here today without the work that Councilman Ring has put in to getting this event organized and getting the sign coordinated and done. And since Councilman Ring's now been on the council since January, we had the honor of running together last year. He's been just such a dedicated public servant that it would not shock me that if we're here in, I'm going to guess how old Tim is, but if we're here in several decades, that we could be telling stories about all the things that Tim will accomplish in his time in public service. We could go through the whole many of things that he's already done with community service. So I really want to, again, while people thank me, I showed up at 6:15, I had a run of show here, and it's really Councilman Ring and our staff that deserve the credit for today's event. So thank you, Councilman, for everything you've done to put this together. And with that, I'd like you to come up and say a few words.
One of the things I have been asked to do tonight is to introduce Bob. And I have to tell you, introducing Lieutenant Colonel Thomas Robert Vaucher, it's not an easy task. It may sound easy. And the challenge is not what to say about Bob. The challenge is what not to say about Bob without us being here till midnight tonight. Because there is so much to say about Bob. With that, though, I do have some remarks I do want to say. I sat down the other day, and I spoke to Bob a little bit and went over a couple of things and asked Bob if there were some things he specifically wanted to mention. So I will go through this. I will try to be brief. But Lieutenant Colonel, well, at the time, Thomas Robert Vaucher was born on December 3rd, 1918 in Mission, Texas. He spent his childhood living on a citrus ranch. At a young age, Bob took an interest not only in planes, but learning to fly them. He attended the Pan American University, and on April 25th, 1941, at Brooks Field in San Antonio, Texas, Bob was commissioned as an officer in the Army Air Corps with a pilot rating. After the attacks on Pearl Harbor, the start of World War II, Bob flew his first official mission on December 9th, 1941. And it was kind of a, what it was described to me as a top secret reconnaissance mission that also caused Bob to miss his wedding. But he did manage to travel to Somerville, New Jersey the following week, and he married Eleanor Bowie on December 15th. Following his wedding, as I understand the story, Bob and Eleanor spent the night in the car driving to Texas so that the next day, on December 16th, Bob could pilot his first combat mission, serving our country.
From Massachusetts, not
there. Massachusetts, I apologize, thank you. 1943, Bob was one of a small group of pilots called back to the United States to participate in the development of groundbreaking B-29 Super Fortress. This aircraft was destined to change the course of the war, and Bob is particularly proud of being chosen to test pilot the B-29 and going on to fly. In fact, Bob has a small room off the side of his house that I've been fortunate to see. That includes many pictures and memorabilia from Bob's service to our country. It also includes a large model, I'd say it's probably a good 2 feet by 3 feet, of that B-29 plane. Bob is extremely proud of this room. And in fact, the other day when I was at his house, as I was leaving, his daughter Suzanne came outside to the car to tell me I had to come back into the house because Bob wanted to show me what I call his museum. After the B-29s were formally put into service, Bob was part of a group responsible for executing bombings against Japan from a base in India, which included a refueling site in China. During some of these missions and the hump crossings from India to China, several airmen were lost, including Bob's commanding officer and operations officer. As a result, Bob was promoted to lieutenant colonel and ordered to serve as the operations officer. 1945, General Ramsey ordered bombing missions against key Japanese targets, including a mission against Yokohama, in which Bob led, at the time, the longest ever in trail of 454 B-29 bombers. During another mission in June of 45, Bob's group came upon heavy fire. In fact, Bob's second in command was shot down. And if I remember the story correctly, that he was supposed to be discharged prior to that mission, but decided to fly one more mission, and unfortunately never made it home. But on a wing and a prayer, Bob safely led his crew back to Iwo Jima, several hundred miles from their original base. Upon the landing, Bob's crew counted over 400 bullet holes in the aircraft. September 2nd, 1945, Bob was chosen by General Ramsey to serve as the mission commander. He led a formation of 525 B-29s in a flight over the USS Missouri in Tokyo Bay at the exact time the Japanese Empire formally surrendered to the United States. This was a huge honor for Bob, and an interesting note, Japan had waved the white flag and announced they were surrendering a couple weeks prior to that September Day formal signing. And as a result of that, the United States today considers VJ, or Victory Over Japan Day, to be August 15th, to coincide with the approximate time that Japan announced they were surrendering. If you ask Bob, however, VJ Day is September 2nd, because even when he led the show of force flight over Missouri, All 525 planes were loaded and ready to fire if need be. There was a question that Japan was really going to surrender, to the point that the Navy, I understand, had 200 ships staggered out around the Missouri, ready to engage if needed. This year, as we've heard tonight, is the 75th anniversary of the end of World War II. Bob was invited to participate in the ceremony and the anniversary scheduled to take place on VJ Day, September 2nd in Pearl Harbor. Unfortunately, because of travel concerns related to COVID, Bob will not be able to attend it this year. Bob was discharged from active duty in June of 1946 with the rank of Lieutenant Colonel and served in the Air Force Reserve until 1961. In total, Bob flew 117 combat missions, earned 2 distinguishing flying crosses, 5 air medals, 8 battle stars, 13 wartime commendations and citations. In 2013, he was inducted into the New Jersey Aviation Hall of Fame, and he was also recognized that year on the congressional floor by Leonard Lance. In 2014, Bob was accepted as an eligible nominee for enshrinement into the National Aviation Hall of Fame. These are only some of Bob's military highlights in his service to our country, and there's many other things I can share about his service, but as I said, I know we don't want to be here till midnight, and I do want to also share a little bit about Bob's personal life. Following the war, Bob and his wife Eleanor settled in Bridgewater in 1950, where they raised 3 children, Yvonne, Suzanne, and David. You know, all 3 of them are here tonight, traveling through California, Nevada, and New York. And I have to tell you, even to this day, Bob's children bring him great pleasure. Earlier this week, Bob called me, and I answered the phone, and I said, asked him how he was doing, and he told me he couldn't be better. And I could hear the excitement and the passion in his voice as he told me that all 3 of his kids were in town visiting him, and they had spent the day hanging out at the pool in Bob's backyard, where he swims on a regular basis every day during the summer. Family is very important to Bob and continues to be. Bob had a 35-year engineering and sales career in the metalworking industry. In his spare time, he was an avid tennis and golf player, and he also volunteered with the Somerville Lincoln Host Fire Company. Bob and his wife, Eleanor, were extremely involved with St. John's Episcopal Church, and I'm told that Bob and Eleanor's life and social calendar revolved around the events at St. John's, from pancake suppers to men's club to bowling leagues. After 53 years of marriage, Eleanor passed away due to complications from cancer and the associated treatments. Bob and his friend Donna, who's here tonight, have been together for the last 23 years. Bob continues to live in the same house on Foothill Road that he originally settled into 72 years ago. As you've heard from Councilman Pedroso and Lyndon Eaton, Andy Levin, over the last 70 plus years, Bob has been active in a variety of municipal, civic, social, and state affairs. I'm not going to go through all of them because many of them have been mentioned. I will tell you that in speaking to Bob the other day, the one thing when I asked him, you know, if there's certain things he wanted covered tonight or not, and he did tell me that the one thing that he was extremely grateful that he was part of was that Blue Ribbon Committee with the County College and the VOTEC, and that he felt that over the years that is something that he didn't feel there's a lot of recognition of that committee, and because of him and the committee's efforts in the college today. And I spoke to a good friend of Bridgewater, Tim House, who's actually on the Board of Trustees at the college, who wanted to be here tonight to participate in this, and unfortunately had something come up yesterday that he had to go out of town. But Tim is going to be reaching out to you in the near future, Bob. He was not aware of your involvement and would love to talk to you further about that committee and the college. So he extends his appreciation to you. The mayor mentioned a little bit some of Bob's comments around elections and mayors that were did a good job and then they didn't do such a good job and were never mayor. He's been the chairman and worker for numerous elected officials at the national, state, municipal, and school level. As I understand it, Bob has taken a very active role in at least 3 mayoral campaigns in Bridgewater. All 3 of those campaigns were to unseat the incumbent mayor. So if you're ever serving as the mayor in Bridgewater, Bob is supporting someone running against you, withdraw, because you're not going to win. Bob was an ally of many elected officials, including someone I remember as a childhood, Millicent Fenwick, who served our country, as I remember she was a pipe smoker nonetheless too, but through Bob being an ally to many people and knowing many elected run for several different offices, and each time he declined to run because he felt he was much more effective not being bound to anyone, to being able to do what he felt was the right thing to do and not have to answer to someone as an elected official. And I think we've seen and heard tonight many of those efforts. And obviously a big piece being the most recent piece of the Wemple property and raising almost $2 million between public, private, and government money to preserve the piece of property. I have to tell you, the Wemple property was preserved in 2018. We've heard Bob has come to many meetings and spoke before this day as to the officials seated up there. Bob still drives. We haven't had council meetings in the chamber because of COVID, which is why I suspect we haven't seen Bob. But Bob is still out there paying attention to what's going on. The other day, as I was sitting in Bob's living room, he let me know that there's a car dealership on Route 22 that is parking new cars too close to Route 22, which is a violation of the variance that they were given allowing them to operate there. And he wanted me to be aware so that the town could require the dealer to comply with the variance. So even at almost 102 years old, Bob is still out there paying attention to what's going on. Before, though, I ask Bob to come up here to speak, I'd like to go back to the Wemple property for a minute. As you know, earlier this month, I introduced a resolution to recognize the significant and enduring contributions of Lieutenant Colonel Thomas R. Boucher to his country in Bridgewater. And that resolution designated the former property of Bob's longtime friend, John Wemple, as the Vaucher Revolutionary Preserve at Steele's Gap. As you heard, over the last couple months, there's been a lot of work done. I worked very closely with Linda Mead of DNR, Greenway, and the Township Administration in getting this property renamed. And Dave Stempion and Brendan Byrne, who were two of Bob's cohorts, is reserving the Wemple property. They're carrying over a sign right now, and I'd like to ask Linda Mead and the mayor to come forward to unveil the sign. This sign will be put up on Foothill Road. We've identified a spot that Dave helped us with. It's going to be just east of Twin Oaks Road. But before we can put it up, we have to unveil it. So, Linda and the mayor.
Does that make your video feed?
Yeah. Yes, we're good.
Okay.
What, do you want me to sit down?
Whatever you want. I thought it would be easier. You don't have to stand so long. I'll bring the mic to you.
There's so much said about me that I don't have anything else to say. However, I'll tell you a little story. you think all this in? Okay. I don't sit very well anymore. There's so much been said about me that I'll have to talk about something else. So I'll tell you a little story. You've alluded to the fact that I came back from the service and got involved in the government. At one point I was stationed in the remotest part of China that you could get to, 1,000 miles inland against the Himalayas, and it was abject poverty. You couldn't believe the condition that existed there. And at one time we had, I was involved in the getting of the airfield there, which is now the municipal airfield for Chengdu, city of Chengdu. Sit around in the candlelight, in the lantern light, and we talk about what we're going to do when we get home. And we'd all come to the conclusion that our hometowns were being run by a bunch of things. They just had an office and a position, and they didn't get anything done. And we were going to really move things. next thing I know, I'm down in training at a fire school, climbing up the third story ladders, and a guy at the bottom trying to shake me off. And I said, what the hell is a lieutenant colonel doing up here? I couldn't believe it. But it did serve me well. Foothill Civic Association that was referred to here earlier, the more or less ran things. And I was a young guy, and they grabbed a hold of me by the collar and took possession of me and had me doing things politically that I had never dreamed of doing before. But I stuck with it. I was always involved in
thank you again for honoring us with your service, your remarks, and allowing us to honor you today, and for all that you've done for Bridgewater, and for what you represent of veterans, and dedication, and patriotism, and community service. I tell you that many of us in this room, Councilman Ring, Councilman Pedroso, Councilman Padilla, Councilman Kirsch, we're guided by your example, and I hope we live up to your legacy. So everybody, join me again one more time and congratulate Lieutenant Colonel. Stick around, let's do that. And thank you all for coming out tonight. God bless you, God bless Bridgewater. Thank you.